Today is Bethany Sunday. People have asked me, well, what is Bethany Sunday? Is that because you gave out Bethany pens? No. But it was kind of nice to have those Bethany pens today, huh? No, Bethany Sunday, I've named it this. The week before Palm Sunday, something really fantastic happened. I think it was the greatest of all the miracles Jesus performed took place. And it took place at Bethany. And I want to look at that today, that Bethany. Now, some call this Saturday, they call it Lazarus Saturday. It's the Saturday before Palm Sunday. And that's because that was the day Jesus, in some thinking, that was the day before Palm Sunday, that Jesus did this great miracle at Bethany of raising Lazarus from the dead. And so I want to explore that Bethany, this whole idea of Bethany Sunday. And I want to take several lessons from what took place at Bethany. Now, the first lesson that I want to take is that bad things happen to good people. I'm going to let that sink in for a moment. It's true. Bad things happen to good people. How do I know that? Well, look, now Lazarus was sick. Now, the sickness that he has is a mortal sickness. It's going to end. You know, he's going to die. He was from Bethany, which is about 2 miles from Jerusalem. It's east of Jerusalem. It's on the eastern side of the Mount of Olives. So you couldn't actually see Jerusalem because the mountain was in the way. And he was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. And Lazarus was their brother. And so the sisters sent word to Jesus and said, Lord, the one you love is sick. Now, the one that Jesus loves, this is an interesting expression because 3 times in this passage it's going to tell us that Jesus loved him. Now, he loves everybody. Isn't that right? Jesus loves me, this I know. I learned that song in Sunday school. Jesus loves me, this I know. But there's something here in this passage that even the crowds later will say, he loved Lazarus. And so he's got to be a good guy. And he's sick. But bad things happen to good people. You know, there was a thinking in the day back then, and the thinking is in our day too, that bad things happen to bad people and good things happen to good people, all right? The disciples, just a couple chapters before this, they ask Jesus, they're walking by and they see a man that's born blind and they look at Jesus and said, who sinned? Did this man sin or did his parents sin that he was born blind? You see, there was this idea that bad things happen to bad people. And that was a bad thing to be born blind. And so he must have done something bad or his parents did something bad so that he was born blind that way. And we all sometimes have that attitude. Okay? For example, you finally get to the point where you've saved up enough money, you're going to pay for put a down payment on a house and a mortgage, and you're going to stretch yourself a little bit. You know it's a stretch, and you're going to buy your first home. So you do, you purchase the home, and then a week later, you lose your job. That's a financial bad thing to happen. Somebody will say, what did I do wrong? What is wrong with me? What bad thing have I done that this has happened to me? It happens in relationships too. A good, faithful spouse finds out that his or her spouse has been cheating and wants a divorce. And the one who's been faithful thinks, what is wrong with me? What did I do to deserve this? That bad things happen to bad people, so I must be a bad person. Are you see what I'm saying? This is how it works in our minds, that bad things happen. Jesus said when the man was born blind and they asked this question, he said, neither this man has sinned nor his parents have sinned. This has happened to show the works of God. Jesus was about to do something. And what was perceived as bad, Jesus was about to change by healing the man. And he said, this man's condition was so that the work of God could show the glory of God. And our text here, it says there's always always a purpose. There's a purpose for everything. There's a purpose for even when these bad things seem to enter into our lives. Jesus said when he heard this, Jesus said, this sickness will not end in death. No, it's for the glory of God. It's God's glory. So that the Son may be glorified through it. God is actually in control of everything. Everything. There is not one atom or molecule that he is not in control of. He is running his whole universe according to his plan. And I've read the end of the book. Anybody here look to the end of the book? God wins. Jesus rules. Jesus reigns forever and ever and ever. Listen, in the meantime, it says God works everything together for good to an ultimate goal. What seems like in my life such a bad thing, God is orchestrating. He says here, no, it's for God's glory, that the Son might be glorified through it. First lesson, bad things happen to good people. Second lesson, there's a purpose for everything, for everything. I am not always as patient as God is. And that's the next one. It may seem like God doesn't care. There you are. You're struggling through whatever it is in your life. A relationship problem, a spiritual problem, an emotional problem, a financial problem. You're struggling with this thing. And it seems like God doesn't care. Watch what the text says. He'd heard that Lazarus was sick. And yet when he heard that he was sick, he stayed where he was 2 more days. Now, we are the instant generation. We want everything in an instant. My youngest son was born after microwaves were invented. The previous two weren't. We had to heat up the bottles on the stove. But now we could just pop that thing in the microwave in a matter of seconds. He would squawk for a bottle. And you would think, like Pavlov's dog, he would have figured this out. As soon as we put it in, closed the door, he would have known, in 30 seconds, I'm getting a bottle. No, he screamed all the more. Why? I want it, and I want it now. Isn't that the way we expect God? I want it now. Jesus delays 2 days. Delay can be frustrating. I know the delay can be frustrating. I bought a new iPhone 7. So I buy it at the store. It syncs. My iPhone 5 syncs with my hearing aids. It's really nice. I can control it up and down. I can also go in there and if it's put in music mode so that the high notes don't squeal in my ears, okay? It's a pretty nice thing to have. And so I buy the iPhone 7 and I get home. I spend hours trying to get it synced with my hearing aids. Won't sync. Call the Verizon. They work with me over the phone for about 2 hours. They can't get it to sync. From there, we call Apple. Apple works with us for about 2 hours. They can't get it to sync either. I am totally frustrated. I've wasted a whole day trying to get it to sync. They finally say, that software no longer works with the new iPhone. So I go to take my iPhone back. I said, I want my old one back. I get my old phone so I can work with my hearing aids. And I go into the store, and then the salesperson is sure he can get it to work. And so here I am arguing, and I'm starting to lose it, and I'm a preacher. Come on now. And I am so frustrated. It's the little things. You see this little delay in my life? It was totally frustrating me. And here it is. This is a big deal. Lazarus is mortally sick. He's on his deathbed. And Jesus delays. You see, with God, he doesn't account time like we do. A day with the Lord is 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is a day. I am so preoccupied, I'm an American, and I'm really to the clock. Everything's by the clock, and I watch the clock, and I watch the clock on the wall. I'm a clock watcher, and God is not. I told you about the prayer I prayed for this church. I drove into the parking lot almost 20 years ago and I prayed, God, make me the pastor of this church. I don't know why he delayed 20 years. I don't know. He's not on my time schedule. Jesus, you know, sometimes it seems like God doesn't care because we want it on our time schedule, and God says, no, listen, I'm going to do things my way. After all, I am God, you're not. I've got the big picture. I've read the end of the book. I know where it's all going. Hang on, sit tight. Everything's okay. So we read a little bit further, and we find that a death occurs. Wait a minute. Jesus said this won't end in death. And Jesus went on to tell the disciples, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I'm going there to wake him up. And then, I think it was Thomas said, Lord, if he's sleeping, he'll wake up on his own. And then Jesus told them plainly, Lazarus is dead. Lazarus is dead. Now, some people say, well, uh-oh, what's going on here? Jesus said this isn't going to end in death, this sickness, but looked like it ended in death to me. Hold on, folks. This is not the end of the story. It is not going to end in death. It's not going to end in death. My next lesson I want to learn from the story here at Bethany is that all pain holds a teaching moment. All pain. There's no wasted pain. When you have pain, somewhere in there is a teaching moment. Jesus, after he's on his way, Martha hears, so does Mary, that Jesus is coming. And so Martha stops what she's doing. She runs out to meet Jesus. And Martha said to Jesus, if you had been here, you're implied right in here now, but you were not, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now, God will give you whatever you ask. Where is God when you need him? That's the way we put this. Why did God let this happen? Where is God when you need him? Now, if I skip down a little bit further, her sister finally comes out and she reaches Jesus, the place where Jesus was, and she saw him and she fell at his feet and she said, Lord, if you had been here, but you were not, my brother would not have died. Where are you, God, when I need you? Isn't that the way we put it today? We scream out, we cry out. This wouldn't have happened if, God, you've done something about it. It's in this very teaching, this is the moment that Jesus takes to teach. Because what follows is this. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. We are so consumed with the little dot of life. Life is just a dot. But eternity is this huge line that goes on and on and on and on and on and on forever. But we are so consumed with the little dot of life. And something just doesn't go my way, and it can be really tragic, even a death. That's what happened here. And we're so consumed with the dot. If you'd been here, but you weren't, you let me down. And Jesus said, but wait a minute, it's not the end of the story. The dot is not the end of the story. The end of the story, well, listen, it goes on. This is the never-ending story. It goes on and on and on and on forever. He says, your brother is going to rise again. And Martha answered, I know he will rise in the resurrection at the last day. She knows that. It's at that moment Jesus really turns to the teaching moment. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection. Oh. Not that I just have resurrection powers. And not that just that I do resurrection. I bring people from the dead. He says, I am. To know me is to know the resurrection and the life. He's talking here about not just physical life. He's talking about life, eternal life. I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, when you put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, something happens. He said, he who believes in me will live. And even though he dies, like your brother Lazarus just died, he lives. He's alive. Because Paul will later tell us, To be absent from the body, to lose out on the dot, to end the dot, puts me immediately above the line forever with the Lord. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. He says, he who believes in me will live, even though he dies physically. And whoever lives physically and believes in me will never die. D.L. Moody once said, when he was preaching to a mass audience, he said, one day you're going to hear that D.L. Moody is dead. Don't you believe it for one moment. I will be more alive at that moment than I have ever been because I'll be with Jesus. You see what I'm saying here? Jesus takes this moment as a teaching moment, and he goes through all this and he brings it right down. He says, do you believe this? This is the heart of it all. Everything rests on this. Do you believe in Jesus? He took that opportunity to be a teaching moment, and she responds and tells him, I believe. She's just like Peter. Peter quotes the same thing. I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who was to come into the world. I believe. I believe. The fifth lesson I want to learn from Bethany is this. Jesus cares about your pain. Jesus cares about your pain. Jesus sees all the people there and he says, where have you laid him? And they said, come and see. Then the shortest verse in the Bible, John 11:35. Jesus wept. Does Jesus know what's going to happen? Of course Jesus knows. He's already predicted. This is not the end. He knows he's the resurrection. He knows what he has. But Jesus seeing, so when he saw the crowds, Jesus saw them, he wept. He weeps because he cares. You know, we ask the question, why did this happen? Why did this happen to me? Why? You want to know something? You don't want the answer to question why. I have the answer to question why he died. But the answer to question why is cold, it's cruel, it's heartless. You want the theological answer for why he died? I can tell you why. All have sinned. The wages of sin is death. Lazarus was a sinner, so he died. The truth is, we should all die. But God has been merciful. He's allowed us to live. You see, there's nothing warm and there's nothing encouraging. There's no hope in the answer to the why question. So Jesus doesn't give the answer to the why question. He gave the answer to the what question. What happens next? Here's what happens next, Jesus says. Resurrection. You go to be with Christ. You go to be in heaven forever. He answers the what. And we as believers, we're told this is our great blessed hope, that this is not all there is right here in this life. He says, one day the Lord himself is going to descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trumpet call of God. It's going to be a noisy event. And the dead in Christ are going to rise. The bodies, no matter how they've been scattered as ashes or if they're just returned to dust, the body is going to be reassembled. The dead in Christ will rise first. Then we, which are alive, will be caught up together with them in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. And the Bible says, comfort one another with these words. Resurrection is our hope. The answer to the why question doesn't give me any hope. The answer to the what question gives me all the hope in the world. Jesus cares about your pain, so he gave them the what answer instead of the why answer. The sixth thing is that Jesus cares more about your faith. As much as he cares about your pain, he cares more about your faith. It says, Jesus told them, take away the stone. And so they took away the stone. And then Jesus looked up into heaven and he said, Father, I thank you that you heard me. I know you always hear me. You see, God always hears. He always hears. But I said this for the benefit of the people standing here. that they may believe that you sent me, that he was the Son of God. He said, I am more concerned about your faith. Listen, what I'm about to do is so that you will generate faith in me. And then it tells us in the passage here, so you see, I believe that no matter what circumstance you're going through that's caused you pain and heartache and hurt, that Jesus cares about that, and he is not assigned to you any more than you can handle if you will trust him, if you will trust him with faith. And so Jesus cares about your faith, and then Jesus in this passage does the impossible. I look at the passage and it says this, Jesus called in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. Lazarus was dead. Listen, Lazarus couldn't hear. He's dead. All right? Somehow he hears his voice, though. He's a dead man because Jesus commanded it. And he comes out. He's all bound. He's all bound. And Jesus does the impossible. It's kind of like in Ephesians chapter 2. It says all of us are dead. We're dead in our trespasses and sin. And one day God called to us, come out. Did it through the gospel preacher's call saying, believe in Jesus. Turn from your wicked way. Turn to Jesus. Call upon the name of the Lord. The message went out, but you're a dead sinner sitting in the pew and you're dead. You can't respond. But somehow you heard his voice. And you said, I believe. You came hopping out just like the dead man, Lazarus. He comes out. Don't forget, he's got grave clothes on. And the dead man came out, and his hands and his feet are all are wrapped with the strips of linen and a cloth around his face. And Jesus said, take off the grave clothes and let him go. And that's exactly what happens when we come to Jesus and we say, Lord, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. You are my Savior, my God. Like Thomas said, my Lord and my God. When we enthrone him in our lives, he says then, take off all those grave clothes because you are spiritually alive now in Jesus. Jesus does the impossible. Now here's the final lesson I want to learn from this passage. You must respond to Jesus. Everybody must respond to Jesus. You can't say, I'm not going to respond. In the day that Jesus was speaking this, therefore, many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary because of her, to console her over her brother Lazarus' death, and had seen what Jesus did, raise Lazarus from the dead, they put their faith in him. They believed. But not everyone. But some of them. They went and they told what Jesus had done. He raised Lazarus from the dead. And he went and reported it to the religious leaders of the day and Caiaphas and all of them. They knew that we can't allow this to go on. If we allow this to go on, the Romans are going to crush the Jewish state. And they're going to destroy the temple. They're going to take our city and our worship away. And they said, so we got to stop this Jesus. So they began to plot to take his life. So Caiaphas, the chief priest, prophesies that one man needs to die for the nation. They're out to kill Jesus. You see, there is no neutral ground. There's no neutral ground. You are either for Jesus or against him. The Bible puts it very simply in John 3:16-18, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He that believes is not condemned. Here it is. But he that does not believe is condemned already because he has not believed in the only begotten Son of God. You don't stand neutral. We all stand guilty. And Jesus' voice goes out and says, believe in me. And if you hear that voice and you respond and you put your faith in him, you are no longer condemned, but you have been passed from death unto life. Isn't this a marvelous story? This is Bethany. This is Bethany. Let me just sum this all up. Bethany teaches us some great lessons. Number one, bad things happen to good people. There's a purpose, though, for everything that happens. Even the bad in your life, he's going to work together for good. It may seem like Jesus doesn't care at the moment it's going on, but all pain has a teaching moment. God does not waste any of it. Jesus cares about your pain, but Jesus cares more about your faith, that you would trust him through the difficulty that you're going through. Jesus does the impossible at his time, his way, and according to his will. Finally, it's this: you must respond to Jesus. If you don't, you're condemned already. If you do, he gives you life, life eternal. You exchange a dot life for eternal life, forever and ever. This is Bethany Sunday. Isn't it awesome? Bethany Sunday. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we're thankful for the message of Bethany Sunday, the lessons that are taught. May we grab hold of some of these truths, carry them with us, Lord, so that we live in a way that we show our faith so that others will see it and fear and trust in the Lord, so that others will see our faith and say, what is the reason of hope? And that we can tell them about Jesus, the Son of God, who came into the world to rescue and save, who has promised that he wouldn't take away the pain, but he would always be there with us through the pain, that ultimately we triumph in the end in the great resurrection. And for this little dot of life is not all there is. There is so much more. Enable us to be those kinds of Christians, Lord. We pray in Jesus' name, amen.